Hi everybody, it's Tuesday, June 28th, 2016, and this is the Keshe Plasma Reactor Group, and we're ready to start another couple of hours of activities here. Not quite sure what's lined up, but we do have John as showing some of his results from his MagGrav system. And I'm sure we'll, Mario also has something strange and unusual to present once again. All right, so let's get going here. And who wants to start off? John or Mario, or what do we think here? Okay, go ahead, John. How would you like to do things? All right. There we are.
Was 321 watts per hour, and my lowest was 166 watts per hour. The 166 was I took the reading, and then I moved the system. I had it hooked up with the computer and the sound system and the internet modem and my mixers and everything, all of the audio gear and the computer gear as the load. And then Mr. Keshe mentioned about the refrigerator, and I'm thinking about that for a couple of days, and I decided, okay, I'm going to move it. So I took my reading on the 24th of June, and I moved the unit in onto the refrigerator. And it did jump a little bit, but not nearly as much as I thought it would. And on the 27th, after the reading, because my readings are roughly lunchtime, noon, 12:30, somewhere in there, about 4 o'clock on the 27th, I started a fan upstairs in my bedroom to blow some air in the bedroom because it suddenly got hot here where I live. So I had a little bit of a spike of energy come up, went up to 285, but the measured average consumption, which it should be somewhere around 800, 900. So yeah, I won't have like accurate, you know, I'm not high confidence with this quite yet. I'm going to keep going and see if it continues to drop. But, the initial results is I'm looking at, 75% reduction, something like that.
Yeah, wow, that's pretty impressive. Sorry for the people on live stream, missed a little bit of first of what was John was talking about there. The microphone wasn't on, but we got the gist of the last part there, which just to clarify that you already accounted for the ceramic heater. Subtracted from that 1448 and so on, which gives, you were saying about 950 watts per hour.
And about there, yeah. It's probably might be a little bit more because I doubt the heater is exactly 500 watts, but.
Right.
Well, it's at 9950, a significant amount.
Mm-hmm.
And these readings are directly off the meter. I go out at lunchtime and I take the numbers right off the meter.
So. Mm-hmm. Well, it will be interesting over the next month or so and have a look at what happens there, if it keeps consistent or drops or what.
It's going to be even more interesting because I just received 4 more units today, blown up units, returns that were units that didn't function properly, so they were returned to the foundation. And Ella at customer service sent me 4 units. I've got 2 car units and 2 home units that I can basically tear apart and do whatever I need to do to see what's gone wrong, what can go wrong, how we can fix it, how we can make the units better.
Great idea. That's a good idea.
I think I can get one of them working again properly. So I'll be able to have one upstairs as well, which will be an interesting test.
You got some units that came back to you guys?
Yeah, we do have an occasional failure, usually due to improper training at the factory, and I don't know. I would like to go to the factory and teach these guys how to do this, but unfortunately, I can't travel like that. So, They're learning as they go, and everybody makes mistakes. So every once in a while, we get a unit that goes out that doesn't function properly.
Human error, yeah.
And we have to.
I was just thinking about it when you said it, as in it's like interesting to research what ways these systems are able to be faulty.
Yeah, well, there's some of the stuff is pretty fussy with these. If you have a flaw in your nano coating, your system isn't going to work properly. If your connections are turned the wrong way, it's not going to work properly. You know, they're pretty robust, they're pretty tough and solid, but there's a few things about them that's really fussy.
Mm-hmm. Like what would those things be?
Well, the volume of GANs you put on your coils. A whole bunch of people that were making units when we first started working on this found out that if you use too much GANs, your system doesn't work at all.
So really, people making batteries packed in with GANs is no good. It's got to be the right amount.
It's got to be a very, very thin coat, very thin veneer of GANs on there. You make your GANs up about a 20 to 25% solution. So you have 75% water. And you just dip your coils in it, maybe once or twice, and let them dry. You don't need any more than that.
Yeah, it's interesting.
That goes along with the theories on what they call thin film technology as well, where it's the thinness of the film of the coating, the nano coating, that makes the difference. If you put it on thick, it just doesn't work. So it's interesting. That seems to be similar with the GANs coating.
Yep. There's, you know, specific ways you need to do the capacitors. There's specific ways you need to set up your connections. Spacing matters. There's a number of things that you need to pay attention with to get the peak efficiency out of these things.
Is nobody using just the water of the GANs still for the MagRad power units?
Not yet. I don't know if the new style is going to be using just water or not. As far as I understand, you need some GANs in there.
Okay.
Because that's the GANs is the source. That's your plasma source that you're using the electrical vibration to convert. And if you think about water of GANs, or you think about the plasma-infused water, there has to be some way in nature for that plasma to be neutralized within the water, so the water returns back to a neutral state. Otherwise, you know, you take a cup of strawberry-infused CO2 GANs and pour it in the oceans, and eventually the oceans are all going to be strawberries. There has to be a way for that water to revert back to its original state. So I think that, you know, particularly if you're using the energy, if you're using the plasma energy, you need to have a solid source like the GANs in there.
Thanks for that info. Go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, and it just, I hear crickets.
Crickets.
Everybody's thinking about.
Oh,
so anyway, just wanted to show you the spreadsheet. If anybody wants a copy of this, I can put a template up, and you can use it for your own. Pretty basic. The only really hard part is this bit of math right here, and that, because of the way the math is written, this has to be an XLSX file. It can't go in an older version.
So that's a 75% reduction using your MagRav system.
An estimated 75%, because I'm estimating that my normal typical consumption is around 900 watts an hour.
If you say that 75%, is that a constant 75, or it's going to go from 75 to 100%?
Well, if you look at the numbers, they dropped down to 166, and then I moved the system, they jumped up to 208. Then I did two loads of laundry. I got up to 222, and then it started dropping again. When I put the fan back on upstairs, it climbed up to 285. And tomorrow I'll see if it drops off that 285. And I won't have I won't have anything to do for 3 or 4 days, so I can just live normally, and the computer runs 24/7. The lights are on a known time.
75% reduction just off a very short period of time, maybe a couple of days or a week or something. And then maybe a month of conditioning, it should make the system down to zero. Is that correct?
Not necessarily. The system ran for about somewhere around 4, maybe 5 weeks before I started taking readings. So I don't know when it started, but when I come with the next bill, I'll be able to actually calculate. And then
maybe it would take like a couple months or something like that, and then it would cut your bill to zero.
No, it doesn't generally cut the bill to zero. That's the way I understand it, right?
Yeah,
most people get a reduction. It could be anywhere from 5% to 80% or something in that range. But there's no definite absolute for any of this. Every situation is completely different, and the way it nanocoats and works, and the way the plasma works, and the idiosyncrasies of each individual unit. There's so many variables that it could be all over the place until we nail down the variables better as time goes on.
Yeah, I think
the sold units that they're selling that are all the same standard industry standard units.
CE just means that the fact
their system that they coat, they nano coat all the cables of the house, and then after maybe a period of time, it's possible to give the system away to someone else.
Quite possibly.
Two cases that has been shown to work, but keep in mind, every wiring system in your house is different. Every connection in that wiring in every different house is different. There, like Rick said, there are just too many variables. Every single installation is going to be different from the last.
There are two cases where that is possible.
There's been two. Alex in England, he was one of the first ones to report that his power meter just didn't move anymore. And
did he have a smart meter?
I don't know what kind of meter he had. He had a pay-as-you-go meter like they have in England, in London.
I understood this electricity to be an energy that by the law in the States, if someone produces energy and generates energy back to the grid, they receive money from the energy company instead of being charged money. And this system is actually a system that will do that.
In theory, yes. But it's not producing electricity. The MagRav system does not output electricity.
Right. It saves energy and reduces the energy to a state where it maybe even would supply energy back to the electric company, and some people are getting paid for that energy right now.
As far as I know, no. No one is getting paid for this because there's no way to meter it.
What do you mean there's no way to meter it? Sure, there is. There is a meter, a smart meter that people are receiving. Their bill got reduced. Then they started producing electricity, and they're receiving money from the electric company because it's a law in the States. That
did you? Where did you get that information from?
This is gathered information from a lot of different sources.
Name one. That's you mean someone with a MagRav unit is getting paid for the electricity back? From
it's a law. It's a law in the U.S.
Yeah. I know it's a law and so on, but is there anybody who's actually got a unit that's doing that? That's what I'm saying. Is there someone that said that they are getting paid for power that's being put out by the MagRav unit?
From what I understood, the answer to that is yes. And the reason why is very simple. The energy company is very happy for people to produce energy and supply it back to them.
You're confusing terms, okay? Plasma reactors do not create electricity. What they output, you cannot meter. It's not possible.
They produce plasma.
It outputs plasma, exactly. And there's no way to measure it.
That plasma is electricity.
No, it's not. No.
It's the same thing. It's energy.
No, it's not electricity.
It is not technology.
It's not even close to electricity.
It's the same thing with a new terminology because it's a new understanding of the same thing.
No, I'm sorry. I have to disagree with you. I do tech support for the Keshe Foundation. I know this stuff, and it is not electricity.
Is this an electrical wire?
Electricity is a little teeny tiny sliver of what's plasma, what's available in plasma energy.
Oh, okay. So a little teeny tiny sliver. So this is an electrical wire that the plasma would flow through. The two
No. You start right off the bat, you're starting from the wrong situation. What makes you think the plasma's flowing through a material element of wire?
You see, this is a plasma ball.
Uh-huh.
That's a
this plasma
ball. Is there a wire where the
plasma ball to operate? It operates on electricity. The reason why.
No. Yeah. But where's the wire? Wait. Where is the wire that the plasma is traveling on in that plasma ball? There is no wire inside the ball. There's electrical circuit underneath, but where the plasma is, there's no wire.
It doesn't need to be a wire.
That's exactly my point. It can't be a wire. In fact, if there was a wire there, hold it. If there was a wire inside that plasma ball, hold it. Wait, can you listen to me? Can I finish my statement, please? Please listen. If there was a wire, copper wire, inside that plasma ball, it would not work. You would not see any plasma. That is my point.
Okay. Also, keep in mind, Manny, that there are three definitions for plasma.
There is a copper wire. It's a copper wire that's coated with GANs.
Pardon me?
It's not coated with GANs. It's nano-coated.
Yeah.
It is all different.
Right. It's nano-coated and covered with GANs, and that's what transports the plasma, and that's what creates the plasma. Otherwise, you wouldn't have a plasma just in a regular old copper wire. That's the point.
Yeah. Well, also, Minnie, please keep in mind there are three definitions for plasma. The first, the typical scientific definition of a plasma is what you have in that ball, and that is ionized gas caused by high voltage. Okay? That's one definition. Another definition for plasma, which is just as valid, is blood plasma. And what that refers to is a mixture of elements that make up the liquid that you call your blood. Our definition of plasma is very similar to the definition for blood plasma. It's a mixture of magnetic gravitational fields.
What if it's one and the same energy? It is one and the same energy. It is
electricity is a form of plasma, but it's not the plasma that we're working with.
It's the matter level electrons moving around, basically, which is different than the plasma.
That's right. You can take the biggest plasma generator you've got, and it can output what would be the equivalent of gigawatts of electricity, and it will not produce heat. There's no friction. There's no matter state interaction there.
Will it produce electricity?
You can convert it into electricity, yes. But you require a conversion process. You can convert it into light. You can convert it into motion. You can convert it into matter like stone or gold or diamonds. You can convert it into thought because it's the fundamental core energy of the universe. Electricity is a different animal. It's like saying water and a rock are the same thing. Yeah, they're both matter, but they're totally different.
There's something else that we need to keep in mind, that if you were to take a digital multimeter, put it on the ohm setting, and put it across a wire that has been nano-coated, excuse me, you will get resistance readings in the mega-ohms. V equals IR. Using that equation, and with mega-ohms of resistance, you would not get sufficient current amperage to run a device, to run an appliance. However, with the MagRevs, you can, simply because it's not electricity, it's plasma that's mimicking electricity.
This is a whole brand new science. You gotta, one of the things that came out very first in the teachings was, if you have a degree or you think you know what you're talking about, leave it at the door because it won't apply. And it's not an insult.
If I don't have a degree, then where would I start?
Start with the workshops. Start with the, read the books. There's 4 books out there that detail this information. They're pretty dry.
You're saying leave it at the door if I got the degree, so I'm asking you, if I don't have the degree, like,
then you're better off.
Well, what you can do is take classes at this Keshe Foundation Spaceship Institute. It costs 100 euros a year, and you basically, it's daily morning and afternoon classes with either Mr. Keshe or the other teachers of the Knowledge Seekers network of teachers, and learn about this stuff and ask the questions and so on. And then you have access to all the previous videos from the last, 2 years now, I think it goes on, or for the educational section. And of course, there's literally thousands of hours of workshops and so on already. And some of the early stuff is just as relevant now as it was when it came out, in a way, even though each workshop seems like we're on the leading edge and it's always something new and different and so on. It still goes back to the same basics, the same old plasma, and the plasma doesn't change, just our concepts of it, our way of talking about it might change a bit. It's different. It's not the same old science that we've been taught, and it's taken me a long time to get my head around this, because, you know, I'm conventionally science taught, but I've always had a curiosity and heavy skepticism of ordinary science, and justifiably so. And you know, it's hard to start understanding things in a different way, like just the whole concept of having these nano-coated wires and dealing with electricity. To me, at the beginning, was, this can't happen, this is crazy, you can't, you know, this is something we totally avoid in all electrical installations, is the corrosion of copper. And, you know, if you ever see a black copper wire, you throw it away, because it's useless at that point, it won't conduct electricity. If you have an extension cord that's all fried from overheating, which causes it to turn black, causes the copper to turn black inside the extension cord, then it's basically, you know, you try to hook up things to it and they just don't operate. But if we took that same extension cord and maybe wrapped it into a certain coil configuration and so on with the nano coating and throw some GANs on it, maybe it would work just perfectly well in the plasma configuration. So that's the difference. How is it that we have these, like Vivek was saying, these nano-coated wires that have mega-ohm resistance? You cannot pass electricity normally through these wires. But yet, just by wrapping them in a certain way and causing the plasma to move in certain ways, because of an understanding of the way plasma moves, then certain effects are created that end up being able to plug a heater in or plug in different appliances, refrigerator included, which in the case of the refrigerator may cause an actual circuit that's able to be self-sustaining within the system because of the stimulation of the refrigerator circuit upon the plasma. So this is what's happening. Does that make sense to you, Manny, as far as that goes? Do you understand what we're getting at there?
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for explaining that. It kind of makes sense.
I think it was in a recent Knowledge Seekers workshop where Mr. Keshe announced that it was a professor from South African University or African University who said, as far as plasma physics goes, I think it's Ohm's law that no longer applies or something to that effect. So it requires a complete rethink of what's going on over here. I mean, even with John and myself, when we first made our coils, we put the multimeter to it and we couldn't figure it out. You know, hey, you know, we're getting mega ohms of resistance. You know, how is this going to work in a circuit? But when we plug it in, it works. Then we come to understand that it's the plasma which is mimicking electricity. It's not electricity itself.
Yes, and the other factor about using the multimeter on that same wire, that nano-coated wire, is if you put it on the voltage range, you'll actually pick up stray voltages coming off the wire that you normally should be at zero. The meter on a copper wire, one end and the other, or one position on the wire and, you know, right beside it, it should normally be zero, but yet with the you'll see on the multimeter, it'll range up to into the milliamp range, or even up into we have millivolts and up into volts actually at certain times on the same wire. So, you know, what's going on there? That's a strange phenomenon where it's got total resistance and at the same time there's a voltage traveling around on this thing that's not even normally on a wire. So,
well, it's the same thing that, you know, you plug a lamp into the Magrav system, the lamp lights up. The plasma sees the meter as a load. Now, it's a very, very light load. They're designed that way so they don't load up your circuit when you're measuring it. So it only gives it a little bit of energy to make the meter move, but it's the plasma that's actually making the meter go crazy. Because it can't be the electricity. I mean, if you do the math at 110 volts, 1 megohm, which is actually pretty low for a Magrav system, is, what's that? 0.1 milliamp. At 0.1 milliamps at 110 volts is what? A tenth of a watt. It won't even light up a diode. I mean, there's not enough energy there in electricity to do anything with.
Right.
You know, like don't hold me to the math. I'd have to do it on a calculator. I'm trying to do it in my head really fast, and I'm probably getting a few zeros out of place. But you get the idea. The numbers are so small that the electricity end of it doesn't even apply anymore.
Right. So we have to like Vivek was saying, we have to rewrite Ohm's law. E equals IR no longer applies because in this case, if you try to measure the resistance, it just doesn't make sense. So how do you even measure the circuit in that case? And that's one of the big problems you run into with the whole plasma concept. How do we measure it? And this has been, you know, the ongoing debate for a long, long time, and it ends up, for most people, it seems like we measure it by something real simple like this.
Nikola Tesla, they couldn't measure his electricity.
Right, he had a different way of transmitting electricity through the earth and through the air. Hello? Is that Alper? Who is that? No, who is that? Okay, anyway. Yeah, so that's true. So we're stuck with how do we measure it and what is it? And that's what we spend a lot of the time with in the online teachings, the private online teachings, and in workshops like this and so on, is discussing how do we measure the plasma and what is plasma and so on and so forth.
A group down in Peru that I'm working with, Dave Stewart had the same question. And he says, well, you know, how do I know what I can plug into this thing? And I says, well, just plug it in. So they did. And in Peru, they're at 220 volt native. Typically, whatever they plug into their wall, it runs at 220 volts. But there's a fella down there who has 110 volt hairdryer. and they had both the 220 and the 110 hairdryer plugged into the same power bar, and they both worked just fine. We don't have to measure it. All we have to do is know how to use it. That's the wonderful thing about this plasma technology is all of the crazy math. And you know, if you look at some electrical theory, some of the math is ridiculous. And, you know, I did electronics for years when I was a kid, and my dad was a ham operator, got me into it when I was 5 years old. And half of that math, I don't understand. And I'm so happy that I don't have to use it anymore.
Yeah, it's pretty seldom that you see Mr. Keshe using math. And when it is, it's usually quite simple math, like 42 minus 16. And, you know, sometimes we make mistakes doing that too. And sometimes it's estimated and not real numbers. So everything's, even regular mathematics kind of gets thrown out the window with when you get into this Keshe teaching stuff and the plasma teaching and whatnot. But a lot of it works by almost by intuition or by a deeper understanding of the flow, the way the plasma flows according to our observations of other flows and that we observe in life and so on, and like the vortex and the toroid seem to be prominent in a lot of the teachings about plasma and so on.
Yeah, I can't remember who brought it up. It was about a year ago that someone was really happy, and they were giddy about this. And they said, I'm so happy we're moving out of empirical science and we're moving into, I just had the word. I can't even remember it now.
Experiential or...
Well, you just said it. That's why I remembered the thing. Intuitive science.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're going from empirical data where it's facts and figures and numbers and it's all got to add up. And at the end of the day, it has to be zero to how does it feel?
Right. And also, according to the direct observation in that moment, which is always important, according to the conditions and so on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mark, you look like you want to talk.
And we also have Mario is waiting in the wings here to show something there. But Mark, go ahead, Mark. What do you got going?
Oh, not much. I just listening, and now I lost my whole train of thought because you asked me.
Okay, well, you can hook up your caboose and your engine and get her all back in line there.
I will. I'll get back with it.
Zane, I saw you working on some stuff there in your video. Tell me a little bit about yourself and what you've got going on in your Keshe life, at least.
Well, I live in Florida. I've been following Keshe since August last year. And I don't know, I'm kind of shy. I'm stumped that I'm even talking to you. It takes my breath away. I'm serious. It's an honor.
Well, don't put me on that big a pedestal, because it's all just comes right down to ordinary people doing ordinary stuff when it comes right down to it. Yeah, but go ahead. Yeah.
Well, I've just been working on different methods for the GANs. You know, started using the carbon method. And now I got more GANs than I know what to do with. And I noticed in the last few weeks, I've been really working on my intentions, you know, as far as the GANs absorbing the gravitational magnetic fields of certain things, you know, and then me thinking about it on the, you know, like desiring it or having that wish, I guess you could say, of having whatever it is and then getting it, you know, it's starting to happen more and more. And it's really exciting because, I don't know. It's just, a few weeks ago, I had a MagRav that I had it plugged up to one of my AC units and it got too hot. I guess there was a connection in it or something that that shorted it out. So I had it sitting right here, so I was gonna take it apart and fix it, and which I did. But anyways, I had a Monster energy drink sitting on top of it. And it I know no period of time really makes a difference, but it was sitting up there for a while. And the following day, I was taking a friend to go see his mom. We were a good distance away. And I was thinking, man, I wish I had a Monster right now. You know what I mean? But in my mind, I was thinking that with that kind of intensity. And true enough, man, I tasted it and smelt it, and it was like I just consumed it. You know, I was so blown, and I'm going, whoa, there it is. You know, that's what I need to continue to try to follow, that intent, I guess, desire or willingness, you know?
I think often when we try an experiment like that, you know, just out of the blue, just visualizing and actually, you know, tasting this thing, it's all virtual in a way, but it's real because you've made it yourself. I think often when we try it the first time, there's a saying, the first time's free. So you totally grok it. You get that concept right there in that first time. Sometimes it's hard to duplicate that again later because you have to do it very consciously and sort of, well, you know, intentionally.
It's almost like not a conscious effort to receive it, but that wantingness to have it, if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But anyways, I've been producing an awful lot of gains, and I put them on in different containers, and I stuck it's like a big brain, mm-hmm. you know, I feel the energy coming off of it. It's beautiful, mm-hmm. man. Mm-hmm. But I stuck some nano coated wire that just coiled them, you know, just to connect them to see if maybe I could just build upon that, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah.
And maybe intensify the amount of I guess magnetical gravitational waves that, you know, it can absorb. I've been experimenting with different things, you know, setting it on top of the containers and whatnot. But man, it's truly a great experience, you know. I feel so blessed even to be a part of, you know, all this. It's so exciting. I don't know what else to say.
Yeah.
Have you noticed your appetite has dropped?
Yeah. Well, I've been on the liquid plasma diet for about, I guess, 2.5 months, you know?
Oh, really?
I barely consume any food at all. You know, like in the last 4 days, I think I've eaten solid food maybe twice. I can't even remember. You know, it's like, the amount of sleep that I get is not as much as it used to be, but I don't feel necessary to sleep that much, you know? And then whenever I do it, it's a full night's sleep. It's, you know, I mean, I pop out of bed like toast, coming out of toaster, you know? Ready to take on the world, you know? But, you know, that, and then, yeah, you know, my energy level is really high. I started experimenting with the CO2 gains as far as putting it on a scar that I have on my hand. And the scar is almost gone. It's been about 2-3 weeks that I've just every, whenever I think about it, I'll wipe it with some CO2 gains, you know?
How long did you have the scar for before that?
I've had it for about 9 months, and it was bad. I took a picture before I started treatment with the CO2, and then like every week I'll take a picture just to you know, have a comparison and see the difference. Plus show my wife, man, because she thinks I'm freaking crazy. But she loves me to death, you know? But anyways,
right on.
And that's another thing is, you know, since all this has been going on in my life, she's changed. Like miraculously, she's back to the woman that I married, you know, not the one that I don't was bipolar. And that, you know, whenever she said she was bi, I thought she meant, you know, sexual, but she meant polar. But I don't know, man.
What kind of water are you using? Just
sorry, you're breaking up there, Mario. I think you said what kind of GANS water is he using? Yeah.
CO2. Now, I made sulfur GANS because I know Dr.
Yo, Zed, you just said something quite funny right there, man. Excuse me for interrupting, man.
It's water.
I can't hear you, brother.
Mario, you have a bandwidth issue or something. Your sound is really breaking up.
You might want to close some windows on your computer or something.
Yo, Zane.
Yeah.
What do you do if she says that she's manic, though?
Huh?
What do you do if she says she's manic?
Nothing. I go hide in my lab, in my office, you know?
Okay. Excuse me.
All right, but, so, go ahead, sorry.
There was something I wanted to ask you, man. I got these little balls. Well, let me show you. I got some of these, okay? And I was thinking of, I got a little hot plate and I combined some CO2 GAN, some CH3 copper, and I've been evaporating, you know, the liquid plasma in the water into the inside of these for about a month now. Dude, they're real super heavy, you know, just like, I don't know, it's really weird. But can I put a ping pong ball in the center of this with GANS? But does it have to be like one with CO2, one with zinc, one with copper, one with iron, and like the center one with the combination of the three, and then have them on some bearings where they'll spin?
Well, that's there's as Mr. Keshe says, there's as many reactors in the universe as there are stars in the universe, and definitely that would be something to do if you can arrange it. And that's something that all of us, or many of us, have been working on in different ways. Is that's one thing I've done for years, is spinning different balls and apparatuses and so on. I like to spin things and haven't spun enough recently. I need to get back into that. But obviously you've been working with this for a while. You're now into this sort of this high energy state right now of because of your using the GANS water, the plasma water and so on. And now maybe you'll have insights as to how the different configurations could be, and you know, you want to experiment now because you understand something about that, and now you have to prove it, try something else and so on, and then come back next week and report to us how different, how it felt, basically. And that's what it ends up being in a way.
Cool.
So yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else that you'd like to report at this time, or?
Man, I love y'all guys, and I wish I could get into the private teaching, but dude, I'm so broke, I can't pay attention, man. I feel like I could be gaining information or gaining more knowledge where I can help other people, you know, along the way. But I'm just, I don't know, wasting time, I feel like.
Well, you'll find your own position one way or another. If you need to raise funds, one thing that I used to do is just do a GoFundMe or some other type of fundraiser thing, and you know, pop it in the golden age of GANs. Say you're raising funds to take the, you know, the training. It's, you know, it's not that much. It was 10 times as much last year. It was 1,000 euros. So 100 euros is a pretty good deal. And maybe you could find someone to sponsor you, or otherwise, you know, make an arrangement or something, or find a way to work for the Keshe Foundation in exchange for the teachings, or become a teacher. You're learning quickly, and you're actually doing it. And so maybe you want to become a teacher as part of the online teachings. People get paid to be teachers, and if you're paid to be a teacher, then you can take the training too. So there's always ways, and seems like you're anxious to teach others as well, so you can start to do that in your local area. Many people are doing workshops and just local gatherings of people and friends and so on. And like Jackie, for example, he got half a dozen of his friends together to start this plasma feeding, plasma water feeding process and so on. And some continued with it and some didn't and so on. It got everybody going with it, and it started a lot of people paying attention to that whole realm, basically. And so, you know, if you can also, if you can document the things that are happening for you, for example, the thing with your wife, your relationship with your wife, that's huge. That's
yes,
that is the biggest thing. That is what we're going toward. This is what world peace is all about. Hello, huh? Pardon me.
5 years she was going through menopause. And my first magrav was built within a month, man. She completely changed. Completely.
Interesting.
Oh, man.
Yep, so it's good to document things like that. You could put it into the testimonials, for example, and it'll get picked up. And it's just you know, a good way to start interacting with people, and then opportunities pop up as you start getting more involved with the whole teaching, basically, you know. So yeah, good luck with it all. It seems like you're on the right path.
Thank you, bro. Love you, man.
You mentioned in the chat, how can I get into the private teachings? Well, you can.
Hey, you too.
People can apply at the at the Keshe Foundation website and the Keshe Foundation Spaceship Institute, KFSSI, websites. You can look those up, and they're pretty readily accessible. And you can just apply there. You have to go through a security screening and so on in order to become a student, but it's relatively painless.
Yeah.
What would a student be learning?
What would a student be learning? A student learns about the workings of the plasma, essentially, and among other things. But it's the basic teachings of the Keshe Foundation about using plasma for lift, power, new materials, and health experiences.
Hey, Rick, this is Denny.
Hi, Denny.
I think Mr. Keshe is going to start a more hands-on teaching, from what I understood him saying today.
Yes, I guess that's true. I'm not sure. It seems like he's getting back into the lab. Yes, he's mentioned that the broadcasts will be from the lab next time. It'll be more hands-on stuff, so maybe we can expect that in the new teaching in the fall, because there will be a break from, there's only what, another two weeks, I think, of the private online teachings, and then there'll be a break for the end of July into August, and then in September again it'll start up with the new round of online teachings, the private teachings. Then the Tuesday, I think the Tuesday is going to be changed in July as well. Tuesday international teachings. And then the Thursday teachings will continue as always, though. The Thursday Knowledge Seekers workshops will, seems like they'll always go on at this point. Mr. Keshe is pretty adamant to keep that going. He hasn't missed one yet in 120 of them.
Yeah. Hey, Rick?
Yeah.
I had a question about today's teachings. When he was talking about the box, you know, like the container with the carbon in it and the, but there was an element number of 18 that he kept talking about getting to.
Yep.
What is that number? I mean,
oh, it's pretty simple. It's 16 plus 2, which is our good friend H2O. So it's 16 would be the oxygen, 2 for the hydrogen, 2 hydrogens.
So that's on the periodical table? Those are the numbers?
That would be the, what's atomic weight? Is that, I guess that's the, is it, yeah, atomic weight, not the atomic mass. I believe that's the atomic, is it atomic number? No, it's the atomic weight, right? And Keshe uses that system as a way of calculating, at least approximately, how to manage the different elements involved in the on the GANS creation kits and the nano, creating the nano coatings and that sort of thing.
So when he says it's the atomic number, that means atomic
weight.
Oh, the atomic weight.
Right.
Okay.
The bottom number on the little box. Not the top number. If you look at the periodic table,
uh-huh, I'm looking right now.
At the top, then you'll have the name of the element.
Uh-huh.
Then you'll have a couple of numbers below that, and at the bottom one typically is your atomic weight.
Well, here I have like for copper. Can you see?
63.546 is the number you're looking for.
63. Okay. So when he says that 60, well, I'm just trying, how does he figure out that, you know, because now we're trying to figure out the number of the field, you know, of the product that we want to make in between, correct? Like, so that basically, if we have.
Yeah, I was working on this earlier, and I don't remember exactly the percentages, but the nano of the material is, I think, 60% of the atomic weight. The GANS of the material, I think, is 40% of the atomic weight.
So, like, just say if we started off with copper and it was 63.5, and then you, and that was only 60% of that weight.
I think it was that a little more than that for the nano, wasn't it? Like only 5 or 10% difference there?
I've heard a couple of different ones, Rick. I'm so confused on this.
Yeah,
I'm not sure which.
It is, but confusing. It's definitely confusing. There's a lot of variables involved and is approximations and so on, according to the results that are actually gotten from it and trying to refer back and so on. It's definitely.
Yeah, because Vivek and I were trying to work it backwards. Mm-hmm. We're going from the way he's got it set up to make the GANS of gold, using tungsten and copper, and we're trying to do the math backwards, and it doesn't matter what direction I take it in, it just doesn't add up. So clearly I'm missing something on this. But that's basically the theory is, you take, if you're working with nanomaterials, you take the nano number, which is gonna be you know, anywhere from 60 to 85% of the atomic weight of both materials, and the difference is going to be the material you're going to collect. Now, from today, it also seems that you have to factor in the water, the sodium, if there's any chlorine in the water, all the other stuff that's in there too, is going to have an effect on this. So this is why, again, the variables start to stack up and it starts to get untenable just to do a quick estimate.
Yeah, and I also wonder, like, for example, when you're trying to get CO2, we use CO2 as the element or the molecule that we're trying to get, but is it CO2? Is it, maybe it's a carbonate, for example, that it could be a CO3 or CO4 configuration or some other form of carbon dioxide that gets embedded into that molecule, basically. In that case, it would be a heavier weight and it would be different. So it gets a little bit arbitrary there. So that's why numbers don't work good with the plasma stuff, in a sense. It's almost like the numbers are made up, and you use a hammer and a big punch to try to drive them all into place.
Using numbers of that people derive from material, right? Well, elemental.
That's a starting point. We gotta start somewhere,
right?
So far, the only starting point we have that seems to be remotely accurate, at least they're doing it in the lab. Armin understands it. Mr. Keshe understands it. So it's got to be able to be done. They're starting with the atomic weight. And they're adjusting that for either a nano or a GANS condition and doing their magic voodoo and coming up with the right answer. And I'm really trying to figure out this magic voodoo because I want to be able to do it too.
Just pick a point, Mark. You know, I'm sort of arbitrarily working off 70%, from matter state. And then in time, we're going to be able to fine point that, but you got to start from somewhere.
Right.
Cheers. Tony from Australia.
Yeah.
Hi, Tony.
Hi, Tony.
And the idea makes sense in this discounting of the full weight and in that sense of the nano material. Spotlight my hand expressions here. When you have that that layer of the element, say copper, for example, you got a chunk of copper, and then you have the nano coating on that surface, and it's
popcorn.
It's more broken up. Yes, it's like popcorn or sitting on the surface in a way. And so therefore it's more open, it's a more open structure. The actual atoms are more apart as opposed to in the metal where they're closer together. It's almost like being in the gaseous state compared to the solid state. But and then from the nano we get the GANS, which is even more dispersed, even more has more freedom, you might say. So in that case, it's that GANS material is given even more of a discount from the molecular weight of the element itself, because it is that, after all, the table of elements. It's not the table of plasma or the table of GANS or the table of nano or anything like that. So it's a table of elements. It's about the heavy metal elements. So this is why we have a hard time configuring and matching exactly. We're trying to match things in the matter level world, the physicality world, with something that's more ethereal, more the plasmatic world, dealing with fields and with Magrav units, whatever that is. It's hard to measure.
Mm-hmm. I built this. It's like a Q6, a cone device, and I wired it. I put GANS in my ring capacitors, and whenever Dr. Keshe was talking to me about the plasma warming this up, I realized that this device that I made, whenever I get in the surroundings of the fields, it warms my body, like my inside. It's like a comfortable temperature, but I can feel it, the way that it's circulating through it. And like, it's going in like a counterclockwise rotation, but I can feel it, the way it circulates, the warmth through my body. And I was wondering if maybe it was the amount of capacitors that were on it that were, creating that,
I'm not sure. That's a really interesting observation, and that's something that we've discussed on some of the online teachings, private teachings, and as well as some of the workshops, is how do we create heat? And Mr. Keshe has said, you don't have to heat up your whole room, you don't have to heat up everything. You just have to heat your body, essentially, and if you're comfortable, then it doesn't matter whether it's, you know, icebergs all around you in a way. If you're comfortable and bare naked, then what the heck? So it's creating these fields that enable us to maintain a certain body temperature. Maybe you've, discovered an aspect of that you can work with. How's it work in the winter time when it's really cold? Can you turn your heat off in the room and still be comfortable and that kind of thing? Start pushing the limits and trying to figure out how to multiply that effect more and create a heater, and you've got the world by storm then, literally, if it's a snowstorm.
Yeah, I think that to answer your question a little more on that, I don't think it's the capacitors themselves, because you've created the conditions of the interacting fields which generate the heat. It's a combination of all of the factors that you're working with. So it could be the configuration of the coils, the type of fields you're creating, because if you make the Magrav system with the three flat coils, you're creating a toroid donut. If you make the 90 degree coils like the health unit, you're creating a spherical type field.
I was putting this one together.
Yeah, with
how it acted.
With that, you're creating a very unique shaped field. Yeah. And it could be that the unique shape of that field creates the right interactions to generate the feeling of heat.
Well, that's not the one that does it, but I wanted to see if that one would do it though.
Yeah, well, you understand what I'm talking about, yeah, though, right? It's not you don't just make a capacitor and yeah, here's a heater.
Right.
It's going to be a combination of all of the elements of that reactor system creating a certain field shape, field strength. I'm a musician, so I see it as a frequency, yeah, of fields rather than a field strength, which is probably incorrect, but that's just the way I visualize it right now. And you're hitting the right chord that is right in your body.
That got Mario going. I think that's
all right.
Is that what I heard? Was it Mario in the background?
Yeah, no, that wasn't me. But
oh, sorry.
Me.
Oh, it was Armin. Armin is in there, I guess. Hi, Armin.
Ah. Hello, guys.
And yes, Mario, we still want to hear from you too, but I thought that was your cue there for a minute. But maybe it's Armin's cue. Did you want to say something there, Armin, about this?
It's not frequency.
Oh, I understand that, Armin. It's just that's just the way my brain goes to, yeah, just because that's what I'm used to thinking of.
Crazy.
But what? And I, yeah, what about the idea of a pulse, though, Armin? Isn't that involved? There's some sort of oscillation, some sort of vibration.
When you create a plasma, it creates its own pulse. In a point of inception, you create a child. In point of inception of plasma, you create your plasma. In point of fields coming together, let me put it this way.
Yeah.
And after, you don't need motors or balls, what you have. You already create the plasma. It's creation of yours, correct?
It's a good way to put it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
After that, how you're going to call it frequency when you have a field?
It's like calling your kid, it's just a frequency. Your child. it's just a frequency I happen to run into. It's how do you name your child a certain frequency? It's not, it's different than frequency, I guess. Go ahead. Sorry, John.
Yes, I've been called a perpetual motion machine, though, in my day.
Right.
If you transpose so many octaves up or down, you will get vibrations at the matter level, the same way, I guess, that would translate to sounds to us as music. So even though we hear music as vibrations of sound, the patterns that make a musical note musical harmony different than other sounds is because they're that flower of life layers in the golden ratio, so to speak. They're harmonizing. Those are plasma structures. So those resonate in all octaves. So plasma, in a way, is music, but it only at a level of vibration. But it is the same thing. And in fact, I think that's, there's a way to turn the periodic table of elements into musical tones. It would be much more accurate. It'd be much easier to harmonize notes than it would be to try to calculate these atomic weights, which are really arbitrary from a wrong understanding of matter and all that. You know, I mean, that's what I was coming to say before, but I think there's something about what we call harmonic, what do we call it? Sympathetic vibrations that resonate. Anything that's the same field strength is going to harmonize. So that happens on every octave. So music is, there's a difference between music and sound. So we talking about vibrations is the same understanding. There's no such thing as a hydrogen atom. There's field strengths. So but we call it atomic weight one. So, okay, you know, that's, anyway, just thought.
I think we lost Muriel.
You lost your last sentence.
I'm in China again, and the internet is pretty bad. Yeah, you know, I've been living on the plasma water too for a few months. But first of all, Zane, have you noticed a difference in your perception?
Are you connected with your Ramanaj?
Yes, man. Whenever I'm around people, it's weird. It is so weird. I can't watch TV at all.
What happens when you watch TV?
Everything. I see through everything. It's like, you know, I already know the emotion that's being played or what they're trying to accomplish. You know, it's weird. It's, I get around people, it's the same thing. You know, they really don't have to say too much. It's their body language. It's just everything. It's just this interaction. It's really, really weird. Now, you know, my wife's agoraphobic, so, and we live out in the woods. We got 10 acres out in the Croon Forest. And it's like, I got to go do all the shopping. So every time I go into town, it's, you know, it's like interaction, but it's quick. So I got to get this done and then get home, you know? And it's really weird. It's really, really weird.
Yeah, there's a thing about her perceptions that are, you know, definitely, I've noticed a lot of things. Since I came to China, I've actually crashed and burned. I've been eating because I can't get copper oxide. I'm going to start my video here. This is what I got when I
don't know if we'll be able to see your video, but we'll give it a try, Mario.
Make a copper plate and a nano. It's like green gray.
Are you trying to show your video? Are you trying to show your video? I'm not sure if we're getting it yet. Oh, here we are. Oh, let me spotlight. Okay, there we go.
Are you using any
amperage? I'm using amperage, yeah, but I've tried low voltage, high voltage, just having it connected. As soon as I start oozing off this brown stuff, I got this green pea soup stuff a number of times. It started out finally, I put the negative on the copper plate thinking I'm getting this stuff coming off the copper. So I put the negative on the copper plate and it started coming off blue. I got blue and I went, finally, I got some copper oxide, but then it turned to this green and now it's going gray. And I haven't been able to make any copper oxide.
You just released your nanomaterial in your environment. When you connect,
is that what it is? The nano layers are coming off.
Yeah, because you connected maybe higher a voltage or amperage. What's the amperage you connected to?
Oh, like 0.5, something like that. Whereas it might have gone up. I tried it at 1.5. I tried
amperage should be 1 or 2.
Yeah. Okay. Usually. Yeah, 1.5 and then 0.5 volts is what I usually use standard. I tried that, but I guess it's the nanomaterials coming off. Is that what it is? I've been using the same plates over and over again. So is that what it is? Yeah?
Yes, that's why. Okay. If you use a very low current, you will see your nanoparticles coming out. Let's say if you put copper in the copper, it will be blue actually, because it has a time converted or actually attached to itself to oxygen, then you get it blue. If you put a higher current, it cannot get oxidized as soon as possible. Still, it gets oxidized, but the color is different because of rapid release.
So, I mean, looks to me, it behaves like GANS. In the bottom of the container, it's got like fibers. It looks very much like CO or carbon oxide.
They're more of a nano because look, I explained that yesterday. If you increase your current, it's more hydrogen. It's released in the water.
Excuse me, can I ask you guys where you guys hide the spaceships?
What?
Can I ask you guys from the foundation, where do they hide the spaceships? Where do you guys stash your spaceships?
Everybody hides in their home.
Well, you hide in your house.
I'll show you where I hide mine.
Where do you stash your spaceship?
Here. That's home.
The spaceships are underneath our hats.
It doesn't doesn't have any trouble compacting itself into there, then?
Nope, our spaceships are, can be, many of them on the head of a pin, dancing.
Harmon?
Yes?
When do you,
who's talking?
Harmon, this is Mark from Detroit.
Uh-huh.
I have a question that maybe you can answer for me.
Okay.
I started nano-coating my copper wires in a hot caustic solution.
Mm-hmm.
I took a roasting oven and I turned it up as high as it would go, and it took the just water. I just diluted about a gallon of water to about 9 ounces of lye. And I put it in a roasting pan and I did my process of making nano coating for my copper wire. But what I did was, and I was telling these guys a couple of weeks ago, I took the nano copper and dipped it in ice cold water,
mm-hmm.
right out from the hot roasting pan water, right into the cold water.
Yeah.
So now, after I was all done with that, it produced GANS for me. Or something that looks like GANS, and I don't know what it is. I've washed it. Pardon?
On top is blue?
Yes.
Okay. So it's a rapid release of the GANS, and you right away, see, this is the point. You right away changed the condition and brought it cold water. So this is, when you do the caustic, this is how the process is done. Because if it's hot, you don't see it. When you dip it, your material in the caustic, this is what happens. The layer are separating from the copper. Now, when you put it in a cold water right away, you saw the process with your eyes. It becomes a blue on top because the GANS are released and right away cannot detach themselves from the matter. So you see the blue color. It's a GANS attached to the, your material, nanomaterial.
What type of GANS would it be then? Would it be copper oxide or just?
Yeah, copper oxide gas.
Okay. Because I've washed it 6 times now and the pH won't come down to 9.2. It started out at 11.5 and came down to 9.2 and it won't wash out anymore.
Yeah, because you layer, you just take it out. So now whatever it stays and it's attached to it, so you can't change that.
Okay, so it's gonna just stay the way it is and I can use that as copper oxide GANS.
Yeah.
Oh, great, great, thank you.
Excuse me, may I ask the Plasma Foundation if you guys, do you guys use the revolutionary biological power?
No.
Like the cosmic pulse of life, biological power.
It's not biological power. It's a plasmatic power. In a given position, if it's all the conditions are good for life, there is a life on a planet. But what life you see, it's life for us. But do you see higher, you know, fields? You can't.
Is the plasma also biological power?
It's not biological power. Plasma is totality.
It's what? Excuse me.
Plasma is totality. Whatever you see, it's a matter or in a gas state or in a plasma state, it's all the same.
Plutarity.
Totality.
Everything comes from the source. You see the sun. The field you see, it's a plasmatic field. It goes to the end of your, you know, solar system. It slows down enough that you see matter is created. Then you see gaseous planets. And when fields are getting more stronger, you see matter, like matter planets, like Mars, like Earth. So it's all the same. It depends on the position. Millions of years ago, our planet, it supported for bigger animal life. Let's say there was dinosaurs, but right now you cannot see that. Why? Because what millions of years ago, the position of our Earth was different that time when it's now. We are more near to the sun. We don't see huge animals on our planet anymore because life is not going to support. Because the field changed now. Now we are in different position.
Yeah, I saw this film. It's called Tomorrowland, I think.
Tomorrowland.
Amazing. In this movie, Tomorrowland, they show all the technology of the future that the spaceship Keshe Foundation is able to produce right now today.
It is, everything is simple. We complicated ourselves so much that we cannot see. When you understand, when you do things, then you see it. Then you see it yourself. That's why we're trying to teach everybody not to change their mind, to change their perspective.
But that is the key, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Hey, Alper, what do you got going on there? I see something interesting.
Wake me up when it's all over.
Hello?
I've heard the second voice. I was wondering if anybody wanted to say anything else before I...
No, go ahead, Alper.
All right. This idea came from the last Tuesday's, the end of the meeting on Mr. Rick's, Mr. Rick Kremen's meetings, the Google idea was the idea that it really captured me. I've been eating myself and trying to understand it. And how can it be? How can we? And how can we actually put it into a sentence? And so I started building things by the influence of Mr. Arman and Mr. Rake, and Mr. Keshe joined in the end. I was thinking of seeing it with these jelly balls, and then I've dismantled binoculars and stuff like that, and I said it's not the binoculars, so what is it? Oh my goodness, what is it like? I've been eating myself, how it will work. Never mind about how to create the plasmatic condition to be able to see and create the exact level that the person requires to be able to see its surroundings, but how it is going to happen. So I had this idea from the past, again, from the history, and from our Ottoman Empire. People used to wear things like this on their head. They shaped exactly the similar, like a pumpkin, and they used to put their heads, and I'm not sure what they felt, what they perceive, but kings, sultans. By the way, I'm terribly, terribly sorry. It's like I promised in previous, I don't know which one, again, Mr. Rick's meetings, that I purchased these, and I thought it was a joke, and I thought I'd definitely wear it because I've seen him wearing his lab I don't know what you call it, whatever you wear in the lab, in the white thing, and then so I put all this just for that, and I know, okay. No response. But let's go back to that. Okay.
You don't have to explain to like the mystery.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, well, maybe I do. Maybe I don't. I felt like it. Seeing it is actually, if it's not going to be with our eyes, how are we going to see it? How are we going to perceive it? How are we going to be conscious and understand what is in the next level, help with the help of this unit, and with the help of layering GANs and in a certain level, and within its layers it combines, and what does that mean, like how does that work? So if you're not going to see it within our own eyes, which I believe that is not going to happen, and then how with our heart's eyes, but I'm not talking about in a literal way, in a sort of in our culture we talk about it, it's a common thing that like you have to have a soul to be able to play an instrument, or when you're listening, even a listener perceives sort of stuff like, oh, he doesn't have a soul. Well, what does that mean? Like, what's that mean? And going back to this idea with everything else, cutting it right in the middle, heart is actually has its own magnetical gravitational fields, absolutely study hard. I study a bit, not that much. I mean, I'm not an expert, but I wanted to look at it. How would you see it with the heart? So I wanted to replicate the heart. So I had to unify the whole chamber of the heart with one GANs. And then I had to put different layering right in the middle, and it goes in there, or it goes this way. What happens and how I perceive it? This is not actual perceiving with our own eyes. It's like sort of, as I explained it last week, when I was looking at the Starship configuration and cascading configuration, I mentioned that I was sort of fainting, and you know, I needed to hold somewhere, and then I stopped. Well, I continued a little bit more. No, I haven't gone anywhere because I've taken it off. Fainting is not really fainting. I that's where I stopped. It's not actual physical and not being able to move, or you know, move your limbs, and but it's actual not being able to. It's like your room disappears, where I had to pull it out. After that, hands were shaking. I was shaking. So I realized that the thing was heavy, I mentioned last week, was in there, and it's actually not, but it needs to be cleared out. It needs to be super clear. There are bits in there, and how it affects, how you perceive it, it's a sizzling and tingling feeling, and being able to see things, perceiving, you can't continue, because I couldn't continue because that I need to wait a little bit, just a little bit, like the digestion system. I need to digest it, and I need to sort of simply feel it. So I took it out, this part, and I moved on to different sort of perceiving and understanding the field interaction. I had to play a little bit more. And so whatever I have, nothing special really. I mean, even this is stupid, nothing. Just before, 5 minutes before the meeting, there was a fly in there, and it didn't make a big difference. So it stayed there for a long time. It didn't move. I pulled it off. Even after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, it really didn't want to move out. What is this? This is something where it's all unified. What is a unified means? The one gans in it. It's all CO2. And where did I come here? Mr. Keshe told me that there has to be a magnetical and gravitational field has to be understood and created within its layers. So I went into sort of circling it all out and creating a space, because that's the interaction happens actually where in the space. In the space. So I have some 50-50 sort of ratio vapor. I will come to that, how I made the vapor, and some liquid GANs as well. You must have liquid GANs so that you know how much vapor you put into it. And I really need to drink something.
So Alpha, where do you go next? What do you want to do next?
What do I want to do next? This has to be really understood by me. Going somewhere is actually, well, that was the brilliant question that I was wondering about the whole week. Is with our system, with Mr. Keshe's system, yeah, it's so simple. I wish I could continue super relaxed, talk, but I don't want to come to a point where I'm like, bringing out everything and then it's all jumbled up again. Just like a little by little, and I understand it as well as I'm telling you, and second times and three times and third times, I have to adjust this. Going there is not physical. But it is physical, kind of.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hey, you're there, you're doing it. You know, it's like you might be on the cutting edge. You might be there alone doing it, but
you're alone as well.
That's what counts. I mean, we're
no,
all
no, no, no. No, don't get it. Don't.
Good for it.
Thank you so much. I so appreciate it. But the understanding of it comes from Mr. Keshe, and the whole understanding aligns with my understanding. And you know why? Let me tell you why. Because I feel equal as any king or any queen or any president or anyone. I feel exactly the same level. So therefore, no one is above me to control me or below me that I rule them. I'm into a position where I feel everyone is super, super duper cool. Where that's just exactly why I love Mr. Keshe. That is just exactly where the line is drawn. Why? Because I can't really explain it in because of the overwhelming and everything. Let me not use the word. Did you feel what I meant?
For sure. And
okay, hey, this is the field.
And we're all on our own path, you know. And
absolutely.
Keep it up, you know.
Thank you so much.
Good.
What you felt was the field that was generated via everything combining all together. This is just what it is. That's how I've seen it, and I put it. There's no significance. It's all been written. I've written it, everything on it, and where they collapse and the spacing and everything is in there. And I'm just trying to understand how it will work and why it will work. So I'm trying to put it into an understanding where I understand. It's like the heart seeing, not actual seeing, or a sort of not an actual physical traveling kind of, but you travel, you go wherever you want. Before you, if you want, you can send your physical body after you. That was the last thing I say, really. It's so ridiculous. I love you all. Like, I don't want to advertise myself. I hate it. I don't want to advertise my country. I'll only, after the science and the knowledge, when the knowledge and information comes, there are no names and figures and titles and all that. As Mr. Keshe says, there are no titles in space. There are no titles on the surface here on this earth. Absolutely no, none. Yeah, man. Zane, thank you. It was a great talk. Thank you so much.
No, your story is inspirational to me. You know, it's been a different path, but I love to hear your story. Thank you.
What I get the inspiration from you. You get the inspiration from me because I got the inspiration from you. You've shown me many of your animals, and you're so loving, man. You're so, like, when you talk from your heart, that's just it. Okay, one other thing that it came to my mind, why I put this up on the top of it, and it resembled the heart of the seeing, being able to see it with your heart, because I thought everybody would knew this anyway, because it's so common in our culture.
What did you just say about the travel?
The last word, please. The last.
May I ask what you just said about the travel?
Traveling, okay, it's like stepping up while we're achieving the inevitable. It's coming to a point where we have to move on, and understanding moves on. How do we travel with our configuration? It's sitting there, it's a small thing. It's the tiny thing, it's just circular and rolling, and there are bits that are sticking out. How is it going to carry me to the space? Or, yeah, how? Like, it's not possible. Where is the shell? That was my first question to the people who achieved this Starship configurations. And previously, before we come to the health section, we achieved another craft configuration, and where was the shell? How is it going to be? It couldn't be 3D. I shouldn't have said that. Physical.
It's okay, bro.
Yeah. I don't want to go into a sort of many more explanations, but yes, that's it. I mean, what else? I can continue more. Would you like me to? Like, would you like me to say little? Okay, how do you go there? Or do you disappear here? No. That was a surprise, wasn't it? Yeah, no, you don't disappear here. Where you're at...
There have been experiences where people are able to disappear here to go somewhere else.
Yes, you're doing it. But before you do that, with what the field was created, the initiated in you, you go before your physical body. If you can, you can stay there. I shouldn't talk about... okay, I'm finished this. And then you decide whether you want your physical body there or not. You're there. There is no time. There's nothing. There's no time. And this is real, huh? This is no joke. This is as real as you pinch yourself. It's just a little curtain that I wasn't afraid. I'm not afraid. This is not being afraid. This is just a person's own adventure, own achievement that is coming to a point where it's like it's going to, are you ready? It's going to happen. Are you ready? You're going to pass the threshold. What is the threshold? I don't know. I haven't been there. Everybody talks about it. I can't claim anything, but up until point that these are all the understanding. But with this, seeing it, I thought I could put it up on my head. Heart's eye is not actually located in your heart. That's also a bit strange, I know. But it's up, it's like on the opposite area. It's in your brain. It's somewhere up there, I think. Why am I saying I think?
What are y'all doing in here?
Excuse me?
Because the mind controls the heart.
I'm sorry.
Well, it's all in its opposite senses, and where we're at the moment, that's what we should start perceiving. It's all really, really opposite. The things that we're looking for is not, it's in its own field. Why I'm saying it, because when I think about plasma, I can apply plasma onto plasma field, anything. And when I understand everything, this has become the threshold recently, and I can do it. Well, I've applied. I'm a painter, I'm a musician, I'm a producer, I do this, I do that. Why I've done it all this time, all those other things, and tennis teaching and all that, and really beautiful talking to people. Why? Do I have any sort of achievements and diplomas or nothing really? I understood the people's interaction, and I have seen them before, them seeing themselves at that point, right at that moment. And then it led to this point where I think person needs to take his own, simple as that. Just take a responsibility, man. Take your responsibility, really. I mean, just go. How many of you have you traveled the continent? Have you left the continent? Just go out and go see other places. Not anything. This made me feel instantly. No, you don't. What? People's minds go everywhere. That was the last thing that I would say, because it's getting into a point where I can't move on to, because it hasn't come to a point, and then I'm just circulating in here. And we see with our heart. Do what you like, Deshin. I love you.
Well, thank you, Alper, for those those thoughts. Feelings, whatever you'd like to call them. Perceptions.
Yeah. Perceptions. Yeah, absolutely. They must be one of those. So, as you described it.
Once again,
thank you for taking me. I can't believe you're taking me. I can't believe you're listening to me. I have always thought, up until last week, everyone were doing the same thing. Especially everyone was just like so high up, and they knew so much, and they were, and I realized it might not be the case. I may perceive something to collapse the understanding, where as I mentioned the last week, that I really need to become the tool. I become the tool. I'm your tool. Use me, guys. I love you, honestly. It's forever.
Right on, Alper.
Thank you.
Very good.
To me. Thank you so much for all the knowledge and wisdom that you share with us. It's an honor and pleasure to meet you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, likewise.
It's nothing, really.
Thank you for sharing.
Don't make a big deal, huh? It's really nothing. Armin is there, and I've learned it from him. Mr. Rick, is there.
Armin had to go, Mr. actually, Armin, but he's not here right now. He just sent me a note that he had to leave.
Yes, you're perfectly fine. His essence is there.
Yes.
And I didn't have to know it. Yes. He's in my heart. Whatever, even if it's not this conversation, those meetings, Mr. Keshe, you, Mr. Reed, and Mr. Armin, and there are many others, in my heart, as I speak with my friends, I just simple is that, dude. Take care. Bye.
Hey, thank you, Albert.
You know, they had spaceships many years ago.
What do you got there, Manny? You've got a book or something you wanted to show? What is the name of the book?
You know, they had spaceships many years ago, and they went to the moon many years ago. So what the heck are we still doing driving cars, and what are we doing here?
Well, that's the part of the whole scam of it all, that's the joke of it all, is we don't really have to. And now we're not putting up with it anymore. We're not going to. So I've been a mechanic my life, and for my whole life, basically, and among other things. And to me, cars...
You're telling me that they built spaceships, they went to the moon years ago, and not only are we all still driving cars, but you're like still a mechanic.
No, I'm not a mechanic anymore. Now I host the Knowledge Seekers workshops. Now I'm a plasma scientist. Now my life is totally different. Now the entire world's going to change. Now it's going to be entirely different. Now you'll see electric cars in 2 or 3 years, and you won't see any more internal combustion engines within 5 years. You'll see all vehicles are self-driving within 3 or 4 years, 5 at the max.
They have that all already, and they had it all already.
That's...
What about... You're supposed to tell me I'm supposed to see spaceships, man. People flying and the stuff...
Absolutely, and that's the next step. You'll watch... You watch, for example, the Tesla car company. You watch the Tesla car company, and you'll find Elon Musk, his greatest dream, what he wants to do, is retire on Mars. That's his greatest... That's what his objective in life is right now. He owns the Tesla car company, the largest solar company in the U.S., and he also owns SpaceX. Pardon me?
What the heck is he going to do on Mars?
What's he going to do on Mars?
Yeah.
Can we just ask Manny why he's so upset?
Yeah, what's, you got an issue with something here? What's going on here with you?
What? I may sound upset the way I asked the question. Maybe I got to put it across so I just clarify. It's more kind of amazement and bewilderment as to try and understand what am I doing here with people driving cars when there was spaceships years ago.
Well, that's right. And you have not only that, but you have your own spaceship. And what are you doing here when you could be out in space?
Well, I don't. That's what I'm saying.
No. You misunderstand me. We all have our own spaceships. This is a spaceship. We have a built-in spaceship. And part of what we learn here is learning how to use our own spaceship, how we can get into space without a spaceship. That is the main teaching of the Keshe Foundation, basically.
How about there's maybe like a next step of going with the ship?
Okay, well, this is it. All right, so now you want to compromise. You don't want to go just with yourself. You want to have a protective, you know, vehicle around you, and you have all the physical stuff.
No. Let's clarify this. I'm talking about humanity's collective consciousness. Not me. The whole universe.
How about just...
Well, wait a minute. That's not me. I don't know what you're talking about, this collective consciousness, because we each have a choice in the situation. And if you don't elect to take that choice, then yeah, you're part of the collective. But if you want to be independent and start thinking for yourself and be conscious, then you can make that choice. And that's the opportunity that comes up with this teaching.
That's as an individual, as a single human being, as an extension to humanity's collective consciousness.
Okay, well, call it what you will, but to me, what we call the collective consciousness is getting an upgrade, let's say, and that's what's been happening in the last few years and will continue to accelerate happening in the next short while, especially.
Maybe NASA needs a little more competition than just one Keshe Foundation Spaceship Institute.
Absolutely, and you're welcome to start a new one, and there will be other new ones.
Man, look, they landed on the moon. Or maybe more people need to work with the Keshe Foundation, so it's not just NASA that landed on the moon back in the day, and maybe we can tell our kids, hey, you know what? We can go to the moon, not just NASA.
Sure, absolutely. That's absolutely part of the teaching and so on.
In the mine, in the real ship.
Mm-hmm.
Like we can get in it tomorrow, teleport in an instant.
Yes, this is what we are working toward on a daily basis with this teaching.
But there's working, and then they already have it.
Who is the they you're talking about?
Yeah, who is the they?
Yes, the funky, crappy old spaceship that's more like a firecracker than a spaceship.
I don't even think they made it to the moon on that.
They were lucky to make it back if they did make it. That's right. And besides that, they just happen to have a window of opportunity when the radiation of the solar system happened to be at a low point at that point. If it would have been at any other point other than the few weeks that they went through, they would have been fried from the radiation.
Be realistic. Be realistic. There's no reason why they didn't go to the moon. There's no reason why we're not able to go to the moon right now as well.
No. Other than if you try it with a rule.
Why don't you explain how we can get to the moon?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
The same way that they've been to the moon in the past.
No, they did it. You tell us how you perceive to do that right now. We're just a group of guys that are
I envision the future today,
You. We want to know how you think you can do that.
Not just me, if I envision today myself, which would include me being in a universe full of a world.
There's a lot of us trying.
Okay. As you like to say it, Mark, forget everyone else's cars. If I imagine my car being able to do that right now, that would be the same way that NASA.
No, not NASA. What are you doing? What part are you contributing to get us there?
That's a very good question. What am I doing to get us there? To everyone, or to me, myself, having my own NASA spaceship so that I'm...
No, we're not talking about NASA. What's Manny helping us to do to get us to a better place?
My only answer to you, Mark, is I'm dreaming. I'm dreaming a world...
We're all dreaming. We have great dreams,
maybe, but I'm dreaming different dreams than other people.
Into a physical reality. That's what Mr. Keshe is doing. We're trying to take a dream into a reality. What are you doing to help us? Except
dreaming about different dreams.
Manny, we only have 2 hours on this part here. We're trying to exchange good ideas. Not things of books of men that did.
I'll tell you a good idea. If you let me, if you want, I could tell you a good idea. Mm-hmm. What I think I could do to make a difference in a world of dreams and maybe even in the world of reality. If I could take every single car on this planet and turn it into a craft.
Okay, that's a good dream and a possible reality.
A vehicle that's already designed for movement and motion, and all the auto is already inside the mobile, and
Manny,
just make it a little more mobile.
Manny, I have an idea to do that for you. Do you want to hear it?
NASA got away with it.
No, we don't care about NASA, but you want to change every automobile into a spaceship or just help every automobile here on this planet? All you have to do is take, this was my idea, is to take a small piece of the automobile and make GANs out of it. So you take a small piece of the car.
No.
Wait a minute. Because that will turn that car into what you want it to be, because it becomes GANsed, nanoed, and now becomes a creation of your intention. So if you're
I'm driving it down the street.
Pardon me?
I'm driving it down the street.
Well, of course you're driving it down the street. But it's what I'm saying is,
it's not flying anywhere.
Well, what people are doing, this is what Keshe proposed many years ago, which is putting a reactor in the front, a reactor in the back of the car, and away you go. In fact, a few years ago, he had a Mercedes gutted out. He had the engine and transmission removed and everything removed from the car that wasn't necessary and had it ready to be converted. And he was in Belgium at the time, and the authorities came in and promptly dismantled his lab and were about to arrest him before he left the country. So things happen sometimes, and this is part of the technology that's advanced by, that are proposed and been worked on and is in process of being worked on by people from the Keshe Foundation all over the world. And this is the idea. Yes, it would be great to take a bus or a car. One idea is you take an airliner with wings, you tear the wings off, use a fuselage, and you put a MagGrav in the front and the back, and you create a positive positioning system that doesn't require fuel, doesn't require the thruster engines and all this crap. You have a positive positioning unit that can transport people from North America to England in a few minutes, not in hours and hours. And this is all part of the teachings.
Yeah, but that's it. You know, it's ancient knowledge. We lost it. We found it. One guy's even got it right now in his back pocket, and all the rest of us are still looking for it. It's all a little bit funny, you know?
No, it's not funny. We're looking for it. Yes, we're in finding it, in fact. That's the difference. We're not just seekers, we're finders.
There's looking for it, there's finding it, and then there's, we have found it, and you know,
maybe. Are you afraid that somebody's got something in their back pocket besides you?
It's not about afraid someone has something in their pocket besides you. It's the same thing, I'll go back in the circle. I'm still driving my car, you're still driving your car, we already landed on the moon.
Well, so, yeah, that's a complaint, but it's not a solution. I don't understand what your issue is there.
Idiocracy and retarded human thinking.
Well, of course it is. That's what we're trying to change on this planet. We're trying to get away from the greed.
Trying to change, that means kiss my ass. Trying means kiss my ass.
No, it doesn't. You don't have any understanding of what occurs in the Keshe Foundation, young man. In fact, you're quite ignorant of what the Keshe Foundation is doing and is capable of. You have no idea of the tens of thousands of people around the world who are trying their ass off to make sure that this planet is a better place to live in, and they don't sit there and just dream about it.
Here's the problem. If you put a child behind the wheel of a car, you turn it on, that child is going to crash.
No, they will not. They will crash because
they don't know how to control the car.
That was 1 year old driving
they
a car
need
better than most
to learn how don't to drive a car.
Send it to someone else.
It's
my
the
friend.
Same thing with a spaceship. That's why Mr. Keshe is teaching us step by step. It
so
has
to
start
if you put
with
a
our thoughts.
The wheel of the
we
car,
have to get our thoughts in order. We must get our thoughts in order to be able to try to control the spaceship. Otherwise, we're going to go flying out and we're going to crash.
Let's just find out why he's so mad.
Yeah. What I hear him saying is he wants it and he wants it right now.
I don't want it, and I don't want it right now. All of you guys want it, and all of you want it right now. Don't fucking lie.
Why are you using violent language and swearing? What are you so upset about?
I don't understand that. Manny, what are you so upset about?
If you can't level with the voice, then it's the music.
There's noise, but there's not music.
You
can't hear the music because you're so mad.
Mad is not mad, it's music.
You're screaming at all of us.
No, I'm screaming at myself. I'm pinching myself. I don't believe I'm living in a world with spaceships, but we're all driving cars.
We don't have spaceships. Do you see the spaceships? I don't see that we have that in our society. That's why we're changing things. Because there might be some black ops somewhere that has spaceships. There might be some aliens that have spaceships. There might be spaceships all over the universe. But we're not seeing them in our society. That's why we're changing things.
Changing it, and now we've got a new thing. That's called change. Out with the old and in with the new.
Mm-hmm. That's what we're doing.
We haven't achieved any change.
What do you mean we haven't achieved any change? You should look at the way the planet was 5 years ago.
Until we succeed, and there is change, we haven't achieved any change.
Change is not an event, it is a process.
Anyway, I got a little bit more of an important question to ask.
Okay.
I think it was Tuesday's teaching, Mr. Keshe said something about Paul and Toga.
Yes.
And I don't want to bring it up, but I had my health food guy chase down some of this stuff, the sopal supal.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, you know, because here in the United States, we can't get the fruit here. We can only get this stuff in a liquid form. You know, organically, you know, I called the African store. This is all we can get in the United States. Mm-hmm. So now he kind of put a hinky in my winky when he said that it wasn't that, you know, it was not a setup, but he wanted that Toga guy to. And so now I want to know if the product is good and what he, you know, how he said it was good, you know, what we could work with it, because as far as I know
it's all still good. What happened was that was a misunderstanding with Paul. The security got overboard with it, and it ended up that basically Paul had gotten set up and he isn't part of the Red Circle and all that kind of thing. And so far as I know, the stuff that he was talking about was all legitimate and all good information.
Mr. Keshe said it was really good stuff, and he's seen the component numbers of it and what was involved in it. And then I called some people about it, mm-hmm. and here in the States you can't get that actual fruit. And I asked the guy in here in Detroit, you know, there's a large population of Western African population here, mm-hmm. and he said, "You, first of all, why are you asking about the fruit?" I said, "Well, I got a little experiment going, and blah blah blah, and I heard it's really good and everything." And he said, "Well, I can't really talk a whole lot about it because it's a banned substance from the FDA. You cannot get the actual fruit here." I said, "Oh, why?" He said, "Well, you know why." I said, "No, I don't why. I called you." And he said, "Well, it does. It has good properties in it. It does a lot of good healing. Now, you can get it all over the world, but you can't get it here." And I said, "Well, does it heal cancer?" And he laughed. So you know what I'm saying. So yeah. They watch all that stuff. So at least I got the liquid of it. And there's some other, the only other thing that keeps it from in the preservative state is citric acid. Mm. Mr. Keshe, the lemon that was in Paul's recipe was actually good. So I thought, okay, well, I'll buy it. And then I bought the cocoa butter,
mm-hmm.
the shea butter,
mm-hmm.
and they're both from South Africa.
Oh, even the cocoa butter is from South Africa, really?
Hmm. Yes.
Okay.
I don't know if you can see yep. that. Yeah, yep. it's, you know, so, you know, and then I just wanted to make sure that this was right. I'm ready to, you know, I'm working with the Ganses now and the food, you know, when you work with, it's two different, you know, the food system and the health system. And, you know, you got a couple different things going and you got tentacles going. So I had wanted to just make sure that I bought the right things here. And now I can start making Gans out of it.
I think you're on the right track. Whatever you do there, Mark, it seems like you're tuned in there pretty close to the Gans one way or another. But yeah, it's all good there, I believe.
I'm working with it. I got my pH meter and, you know, the Philippines just really confirmed what I wanted to know about the pH meter. You know, the guy with the cancer in the mouth, they started using the swab and then Ren and did the whole thing with the pH. So that really makes a difference. I know.
That was using what the CO2 Gans water, wasn't it, as a treatment?
Yeah. Yes.
And it changed the pH in the saliva in his mouth. That was amazing,
exactly.
Amazing a concept that could happen like that.
It is. And it just confirmed the fact that pH really does matter in everything we make, because eventually it's all going to come back to us. You can't have something that's in a high range or in a low range because it's not acceptable to the, you know, this clay that we live in.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah. I'm amazed how narrow of a range the blood pH has to be in order to be normal and alive and so on. It has to be just within a few tenths of a number.
Yep. So a good pH, you know, the strips work well. I bought those and they get you close, but you know, if you get a $100 pH meter, it'll really keep you in a range, you know, making your Gans. Like you said, if some people put if they didn't rinse it well, and once, like you said, you have a high or low salt content with a little bit too much caustic in it, it's going to, and now we've just learned that the CH from the containers that we're making it is starting to come into it. I actually moved away from the zinc copper, and I and Armin told us to go all one component, copper, zinc, iron, and I took it to one other level, of course, I went liquid material inside my containers, material outside the container, material inside the container, outside. So I have six of the three, and we're going to see what happens. You know, now I'm a little worried because we're using electricity. They're using electricity with everything. You know, it's only in millivolts, but, and I'm just using the water or the bubbler right now. So now I'm thinking I have to go out and buy, I don't know what that's called, that you can control the amperage, you know.
A power supply. Yeah, it's a lab power supply.
Variable power supply.
Yeah, it's easy.
You'll change the current or both.
Yep.
So I see Armin using it, and it changes the conditions of everything. You know, you can actually play with the conditions, whereas this is just like basic science or basic, you know, with the air and the water and the bubbling. You're at basic elements. Well, in order to get different, if you're a scientist, you got to buy tools in order. If you're a carpenter, you need a hammer and a saw. If you're a scientist, you need a this and a that. So now we're just learning. You have to learn. You have to take it to the next step if you want to continue on in the growth of learning about these things.
Yep, and Mark, some of those power supplies are actually fairly cheap too. I think they're like $50 or something like that through eBay and that kind of thing. So, and also you could just use a simple battery. You know, maybe a worn out battery would have enough power for most experiments, for example. Maybe it's a good way to recycle used batteries. The ones that wear out might be the appropriate ones to use in to create the GANs with.
Just enough, but not too much.
Yeah. Yeah.
Kind of one of those things, you can just sort of like work with what you've got. If you've got a bit of extra cash, well, then you can, you know, step it up a bit of one area or another.
When I first started all this, I just ran out and bought everything. But, you know, that's kind of foolish. I learned that that's foolish because the technology and everything's changing. And now that I'm going a lot slower, but I'm kind of going backwards a little bit. I just got done tonight spinning another copper for another MagRab unit because I got another idea, putting some vinyl tubing in it. Yeah, so I thought, well, I got to get some more coil. I got to do this, and you know, and you go instead of go sometimes forward, you got to go back to the basics, and that's why sometimes I feel like I'm doing.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of that in this teaching. It seems like we're always going back to basics. In spite of the newest and greatest, there's always that greener grass on the other side of the hill kind of phenomenon. But it's also look backward at the grass behind you because it just grew and it's green too. You know?
Because I made that GANs and that CO2.
It's that CO2 GANs made it grow like there's a forest behind it. Holy cow. And because we keep looking.
I gotta cut it now.
It's our habit to look forward, but we should be looking backward every so often, just cutting the grass.
Yeah, hey. Get a new understanding, you got to look back and go, hey, what did I miss, you know?
Yep. In fact, there's a saying in racing, race car racing, that sometimes you have to slow down to go fast. And it's true. And sometimes you're trying to get through that corner so fast that you're going too fast and you slow down because of it. So if you slow down deliberately, then you can get through the corner faster than if you're trying to rush through, basically. So there's definitely some wisdom in that idea.
Well, I just want to thank everybody. I mean, this is a great group. And, you know, Marin, I didn't mean to step on his toes. I just wondered why he was just so mad. He seemed so mad.
He does, he mentions in the chat here, he says he apologizes for getting, quote, mad or using any words which might cause any offense. It has been very interesting to meet folk from the KFSSI. Thank you. May God bless you all with the work you do. And he's still here, and he can unmute himself if he wants to there and say something or whatever. I wasn't trying to shut you down, Manny, or anything, but when things get, you know, we get mad at the world. It's like he says, the whole world is asleep, and what changes? You got to get mad. That's a saying from the movie network he mentions and so on. Well, you can get mad, yes, and getting mad gets a certain thing kind of done and does make changes and so on, but I think most of us have learned in the Keshe teachings that getting mad, we've gotten over mad and we're getting on to just doing it, basically, and feeling it and doing it and ignoring those who are the detractors and the ones who or the unbelievers and so on. We try to tolerate them and help them along with from time to time and so on, but we don't have to believe their reality, and we don't anymore. We are totally in believing that we can create a new reality that has all the things that we want in it and more, way more. So I think that's...
Yeah, we all love this group for that reason, you know. It can get mad at times, but as long as the conversation goes on, you know, it's like, you know, there's growth there, you know, and as long as it's going in a positive direction and, you know, that's what we all want, you know, and thank you. I love all you guys and I love being part of this group. Cheers.
Thank you, Tony.
Thanks, Tony.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. And thank you, Manny, too, for, I appreciate your input, and it gives a great chance for us to sort of voice our ideas and so on at the same time, and for you to interchange with us. It's good for everyone. So, okay, I'm going to have to wrap things up here shortly. Is there anybody else who really needed to present something? I see Lee Coates is here. Did you have something, Lee, that we might have missed on this week? We missed you for the startup. We had to jump there to try to get something to start up.
Yeah, this week I was out on nano-coated wire and stuff, so I didn't have much to do. But
it's about time you ran out of nano-coated wire and hot glue, because, geez, I bet you had the market cornered on the hot glue there.
No, I had a special order of 10 boxes of hot glue. But two months ago, I ordered all these different plastic balls that fit inside each other from China, and they finally got here. So
it looks like the one that Alper had there, I think, too. Is that similar to yours, Alper?
We've seen them before, but yep. I got about four different sizes that fit inside each other. So now I can do some more experiments with using the balls.
I think it's the same ones that I've got as well. They're two piece, and they each have a little tab with a hole in it that you can put the two holes together and make one tab, sort of thing.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah. You showed them before. Yeah, and, of course, you can get bigger ones than this, but
they're really nicely made, aren't they? I think aren't they poly? No, they're acrylic, I believe. Yeah.
Yeah. So even today, Mr. Keshe was showing us something with two balls inside each other. So
yeah.
Now I've got something to experiment with again.
Great. Well,
Lee, how do you nano coat those?
I just put them in cold caustic and just leave them there for a couple of days. And sometimes I'll take them out of the actual caustic bath and put them in a plastic bag. Or sometimes I just take them out and I think they're nano coated. I'm not sure. You can't see it. So
yes, some people do electrical tests on it too. Go ahead, sir.
Well, I've tried nano coating the plastics, and I've had good results with the heat, with the dipping. You know, it's rough working with that. Not rough, but you just got to be careful heating that caustic up in a crock pot, or like I said, I use a roasting pan. But I take it any of these plastics. They say you can take it up to Mr. Keshe. Let me turn my camera on. Mr. Keshe told us that the hot glue gun shoots that carbon CH out at 120 degrees. That was his little trick that transferred the CH bond between each other. So I thought, well, if you can get the plastic or the vinyl or whatever, you want to stay away from the vinyl chlorine, and not the chloride, or the vinyl chloride, not the.
You want to stay away from the polyvinyl chloride? Is that what you mean?
Yes. The polychlorine. There's a chlorine and there's a polychloride. One that's lead free. The lead free one, it doesn't give you the nasty vapors. And if you can take that up to 100, I'm taking it up to 150 degrees, and it's not disshaping any of the vinyl. If you go any higher, when you get the caustic up, like say 180 degrees, and you put the vinyl tubing in it, it deforms. Mm-hmm. It just wants to shrink into itself.
Yeah.
But if keep it at about 150 degrees, like those vinyl balls or the tubing or whatnot, 140, 150 degrees, it keeps its shape. And then if you take it out of that, it has like a funny film to it, which it's telling me that it changed the molecular structure of that particular thing that you put in there.
Yeah, for sure the caustic will pull out the hydrogens out of the structure and leaves it brittle and so on.
will that keep that active? You know, once, is that nano coating now through that whole tube? Is that, that's the
question. You just want it on the surface anyway. That'll be the way it works. But it can go through the whole tube in the sense that, for example, with plastic bottles, that's the way they decompose them, is to put them in caustic. Otherwise, they take years and years to decompose in a landfill. So there's new methods of putting these plastic bottles in a vat of caustic, and you can actually make fuels out of the bottles that way. So you can change through that process, you can actually make it into a fuel. So, you know, that's something I think we're sort of working toward in a way with our, but on a micro scale. If you can make that fuel inside of a plasma capacitor, for example, and maybe that fuel will last for years inside that plasma capacitor, then you've essentially done it.
Well, I had an idea. I was just ready to run and grab it here. I should save it. You're getting late and you got to get wrap things up. But I think that's the way we're going. So Lee, I just wanted to throw that at you. If you got a crock pot at home or no, I go to these thrift stores and you can get these old crock pots, $10.
You can buy new ones for about $10 now too in some places. Yeah.
That's,
yeah, I've got a problem with the new ones in that, you know, I did the bottle plastic, the plastic bottle routine, and I think it produced so much heat in the bottom of the crock pot that it delaminated and ate right through the crock pot. You know, I'm sort of hesitant to grab the one in my kitchen. I think I'll buy another $10 one, try it again. But it really chewed it up. Once it ate through the surface coating, it was done.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. You have to.
Was it a metal one? Because you can get ones that are metal and ones that are like
ceramic kind of.
Ceramic.
Yeah. One I have is ceramic. It's lasted pretty good, other than the trim for it. The metal trim is starting to deteriorate.
Yeah, that's what goes.
It was a ceramic one, but it was probably not a high quality coating on the base.
Depends a lot on what concentration of caustic you use too. If you use the really concentrated.
Yeah, I was reusing caustic, so it probably been on its fourth or fifth trip through, so it wasn't that strong. But I just got a feeling the heat was too much, particularly I think the heat in the plastic bottle, it was sitting right on the bottom, and that's where it started delaminating, where the plastic, melted plastic bottle was on the bottom of the container.
Yeah.
So I'm now trying to lift it up a bit, so I get the conversion, but it's not sitting right on the bottom of the crock pot.
Well, yeah, for most plastic coating, of nano coating, you just need the vapors. Steam, light steaming is usually enough, actually. Some people use a spray bottle with just mild caustic and just give it a quick spray with a spray bottle.
Yeah. Well,
cold.
I did leave it in there for a lot longer.
Would you wash that off after you're done, though?
I think so. I think that would be appropriate in most cases, especially if you're handling it.
Yeah, washing is essential. I use, if I want to do the nano coating a bit quicker, I use an egg steamer that works beautifully. Within 48 hours, I can get 6 layers of nano coating on, and it comes out beautifully. But it needs to go through the 24-hour caustic immersion first. Then it gets transferred into the egg steamer. About 3 to 6 coats later, take it out, wash it, dry it, and it's good to go.
That sounds like a great idea. I'll see if I can destroy an egg steamer next.
I managed to burn through a metal tin can this week.
Yeah, you should be able to get some pretty cheap egg steamers from AliExpress from China. They're probably maybe $10 or $15. So even if you, and that's basically what I'm using. I've used it now for about 6 months. After every nano round of steaming, the base gets nano coated. The metal plate within the egg steamer itself gets nano coated, but you just put it under the sink, wash it down with a little bit of water and a gloved hand, and that nano coating comes right off.
Thanks for that, Valak. It's that's Yeah, good advice. I love AliExpress. I couldn't survive without them.
Yeah, I've gotten a few things.
Yeah, they're a very good source of cheap stuff. Cheap and good stuff.
Getting better all the time, yeah. Okay, I'm going to wrap things up for now. I have to think about the other workshop coming up here shortly and so on. So, great. Thanks again, everybody, for participating. It was another lovely adventure here with you all. And, it's fun when it gets a little spicy here. We don't get that so much on the Keshe workshops. We try to keep all that down, but here we like to rub shoulders or rub elbows, I guess you might say, every once in a while. And thank you, Manny, for that good rubbing that we needed today.
I really apologize.
No, it's no apologize required. It's all part of the game.
I haven't slept for a couple of days, and I'm just thinking and working on this on plasma stuff.
Right on. Well, come back next week and keep tuning in as much as you can, and just set a good intention, and everything else will follow through from there, basically. So good luck with your plasma adventure.
I'm terribly embarrassed. I don't mean to. I know it's my body language and my behavior. I don't mean to kind of lose myself in that way.
Well, it happens to the best of us. Sorry? What was that?
Come back next week and we'll do it again. Yeah.
We'll keep doing it until we rub it off.
Yep. Thank you, Rick. We thank you for just being the host of all of this. We really appreciate it.
It's been quite an adventure over the last years, I'll tell you. I'm so glad that I got into all this, and it's still an adventure and I think it will be forever at this point.
So yeah. Rick, you're the man. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all. Okay, I'm going to end the live stream now.